much like the subject today, the trading. It's literally a much lighter one because we're going to talk about micropiping. Anyone heard about it? So I assume that everyone here is familiar with pipers in the theory, or at least familiar with it, or you're interested in learning about it. Most of you probably use Python for trading. For those scripts, most of you probably not interacting with the real world using Python, and this is what MicroPython is all about. There are other boards that run on Arduino. Those are programming C. C is not as much fun as Python. So in the year 2013, a very smart guy put up a Kickstarter campaign. He was asking for £15,000 to develop a version of Python that runs on a microchip. He was proposing a version based on Python 3.3, the same grammar and the same syntax. That was his first So the implementation of Python plus a board to support that implementation. So you can be an ARM processor for the development. The MicroPython is not it's running on the processor itself, so there's no operating system. It's what they call a bare metal Python. So in a way you can say that Python is the operating system. It has the MicroPython supports all these, almost everything that is available in Python 3, with some differences. You might notice that some of the packages are called like UOS, UJSON, URE. Those are optimized APIs for the microprocessor. So they don't support every single API that Python supports. It's selected and it's optimized. The MicroPython board, it's board is a technical spec. It's running on 168 megahertz, some RAM there. What's interesting about it is it has an accelerometer, so it knows its position in space. Reason why there was some implementation of quadcopters programming Python. So that's one thing that they've been using for. It looks something like that. It has sufficient pins to do whatever you want to do with the microcontroller. When you plug it into a USB, it presents itself as a drive, as well as a serial port, so you can access it. We have a file system, which basically has two main components. One, it's a file called boot.py, which is run at the boot, and a main.py, which is run just after that. That main.py can be changed to run, in a boot you can specify other file to run at the beginning. I should run some examples. Hopefully to run. Okay, so this is how it looks like. It's this small. It runs Python on it. It's a drive. It has it has two buttons for flashing it, for programmable, one programmable button. You can insert a SD card so to extend the flash drive. So once you plug it in, you pray, and then you have so this is the board. So it has a Py, the main, this is for Windows, and that's about it on it. It also so it presents itself as a Okay. So you get a prompt. You can type any. Is it big enough? Can everybody see?
Yeah.
Is it big enough? So it's basically so the Python prompt. It does everything you tell it to do. 1 plus 1. It knows it's 2. It does. Well, basically everything. It's, as I said, there's no operating system, so itself it's a OS, it's going to complain. So all these files are on the board. Everything that it runs here, it actually runs here, not on the Mac. I have some demos, but we're a bit short on time, so let's have it a bit short. Okay, I'll unplug this one. So in the main, as I said, you will execute whatever you put in there at the runtime. Or any code that it's in there, it runs. So once I did a soft reboot, it goes into execution of that file. Whatever it's in there, it will read sensors, it will do any, if you put a motor, it will turn it, it will do whatever you ask it to do. So there's a little bit of help, what shows you roughly what it can do. It's you create objects like LEDs are objects that you can turn on and off. Let's say it turns it on, say it's off, turns it off. Spell it correctly. There you go. It has 4 LEDs on it. By default, there are 4 colors that you can do as an indicator of certain functions that you're using. You want to see that you're connected to the internet, then on blue, or you're Bluetooth, then you're blue, and so on and so forth. Other things that you can do. It has timers, which basically it will keep running. Yes, no. Okay. Oh, sorry. It does. It is LED, so there's nothing to see there. It's on the board. So basically it's if you didn't see the code, it has a two modes. Oops. So it has callbacks functions with timers set to turn LEDs on and off. So it runs in the background. It has I think 12 timers that you can program for different functions that will just at different frequencies and will call the functions. Okay. Let's go back to this one. But you see, this one currently supports Bluetooth, so you can plug in a Bluetooth. I have one here. A Bluetooth module, and so you can do a connection with your desktop or with your smartphone, or unfortunately not the iPhones. This module goes for iPhones, they have the new protocol, so Android only. But because it doesn't support Wi-Fi for all these Internet of Things, most of the people will require Wi-Fi. So as part of a second campaign, the developer started supporting ESP8266 boards, which are let me show you what. So they are of this size. You can see it. Tiny. So basically this little thing runs Python and has Wi-Fi. So it acts as a, it can act as a hotspot, or it can connect to a network. It's one antenna. It has the processor and some other tiny chips in there. That's the Singapore dollar. That's $1, and that's the.
It's not the price. It's not the price. It's not the price.
It's
not
$2. It's not $1. That's the size. But in order to order it, to run it, you actually need a little bit more. If you want to plug it in a USB, there's obviously no space for USB port on this one. So it's put on a slightly bigger board. Slightly bigger board. About this size. You can actually see it, which is good. And one more example. Let me unplug the old one. So it's connected to the network. It's one of the hotspots here. The moment it's booted, it's connecting and it gets an IP address, and you can access it over the network. This currently runs a small. So basically you can build a small web survey site. I'm not going to build anything of the size of Apache or serve complicated JavaScript pages and loads of data, but it can serve API. So basically you can turn on LEDs, you can turn on motors remotely by accessing a website. As code is very simple, it's just reading the request. From an API, I plug in something that looks like this, if anyone knows what it is. Put it here. Let's try it. Thank you. LEDs. So we change the colors by putting a button. Anyone familiar with jQuery? Yes, nobody's seen this lovely slider. Well, this will be a bit different. So this is a running the web server locally on this machine, but it calls the API on this little. So it just
set the color based on the jQuery style.
That's right. So instead of just the so the server on the little board answers to the command. So obviously you can do a lot more. This is just a quick demo. So back to the there's currently quite a lot of companies developing boards that that support Python, and they are getting more and more complex. What I showed you here is the simplest one. There are some that are quite specific for different purposes. There are some that are generic. So Microbit, if anyone's familiar with it, from BBC, it's for educational purposes. Anyway, all these boards currently, they are more used for education. They're very easy to program for the kids. They get more interested in coding when they see a light turning on or a beep coming out of a device, instead of just looking at the screen and seeing lines and lines and lines of code. So a blinking light just gets them attention, or a motor turning, they can cut paper and put it on the motor, and they do a lot of crazy things, but they code in Python. So that's the price is really quite acceptable. $30 they did for education purposes. And then there are some more, much more complex. They connect to the 4G network, but to the LTE-M, which I don't think in Singapore is supported yet. I heard rumors that M1 and Singtel are talking to Ericsson and to Nokia to support all this. I don't know if they are available or not. And these are several boards, and they have adapters, like the PiSense. This one is basically a weather station. It has all the temperature, humidity, all the sensors on that board. You plug in one of those, I think they're all compatible, and you have a portable weather station. So this is, for example, very good for big farms, which have a large area, and they just place everywhere, and then they get real data. The other one is it's a GPS tracker. So same thing. And the price, again, is very acceptable, $20 to $50.
What about the power when you're using these kinds of things in remote areas?
I guess solar power will do.
Okay.
5 volts.
5 volts?
Yes.
USB?
Yeah. USBs. And that's why you need to use the LTE-M. Those are really low-powered network. You can't use the normal 4G. It's going to kill everything. So, to be honest, that's about it. Much, much lighter topic. That's about it. There's some references for this. It's all on micropython.org. I am not affiliated with them. I don't sell them. I just use them, and I thought it's interesting. And Marty said that nobody actually talked about it, and well, I ended up talking about it. That's all I have. If anyone has any questions, I'll do my best to answer them.
There's only one question. They have given now WebSocket support. Not WebSocket support.
I think so.
Recently they added micro WebSocket support.
I don't know if it's MicroSocket or...
WebSockets. That's what it is. And the new ones. No, I did not use it at this moment. Day before yesterday, so...
Or quick. Yeah. That's it for this. It's completely new. It's from
they don't use R-Python or...
No. They started from scratch because they wanted to optimize as much as possible. You can imagine this.
It's like those JavaScript Proton boards, you know, Proton that you have written.
So they can use that again.
It's similar to R-Python.
You will still be here for
yeah? What are the limitations of this boss compared to like other boss program C, for example?
I think they're more or less similar. The processor, I think it's quite, if you look at the specs, it's probably more powerful than the processor I used when I started programming. Sorry? Yes, it does. I don't have internet here, but I suggest if you're really interested in learning more, you need to read the documentation because there are a few implementation of it specific to different boards because different boards support different things. There's a generic implementation and there's specific to a board. And the documentation is very nice split in individual boards. So you choose which board you use. First you decide what your project is about, you choose which one.
Only embedded systems and embedded GC.
But this one, because it's the Python, so. Yeah.
So all the functions in MicroPython, they are, so what, is it exactly the same syntax?
A little bit. So you have to, if you want to port libraries, for example, you have to try and error. Because or you read the documentation because they are quite specific in the documentation what's supported and what's not, and it's all open source, so you can go and dig as deep as you want, and yeah.
Is there a board with a camera? The Lunarize camera.
There's one with screen. Okay. There's one with a screen. They support all sorts of protocols for communication, so maybe. As I don't see any space here. Yeah, the camera will require quite a lot of. I don't think image processing is something that.
But I mean, you can enforce security.
I saw something that ever.
I seen one experiment in which he was running a Raspberry Pi and doing a facial recognition and identifying objects.
Yeah, the YouTube video.
Just preloading the model and then just doing on the.
Not training. You just load the model on.
And then working on that.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.